Thank you very much for the introduction. I'm very happy to be here in Belgrade. It's the first time being here. I will speak in my capacity as a member of the LIBER Executive Board member, but at the same time I'm acting director in the Library and Information Center of the University of Patras in Greece. More or less I understand some of the challenges that you have, some of the questions you have expressed, because you know, Greece is not too far away from you, and I would like also to congratulate you for having established an open science policy. You are taking some very brave steps ahead. In Greece we haven't done yet, but we recently structured a working team to work on that, and we are very happy that the minister understood how crucial are libraries in this effort, and we have representatives in this working group. So I will try to be a little bit philosophical and very much practical, so it's going to be to the extremes. A new kind of dialogue, open science as a discourse topic between libraries, researchers and societies. When I started dealing with this topic of open science, I thought that this very much resembles to a dialogue. This means that, at least in my view, science right now is turning into a monologue. We have researchers publishing all the time, and as Paul already said before, many of those papers are not even read, or we don't have any indication that they have been read, like receiving citations. So we don't know what is the merit in this. So we need science to be more more interactive, and it needs to be done more interactive between researchers, scientists, between libraries and scientists. For many years, libraries were not very good at communicating with researchers. They were not hearing what the researchers needed exactly. I think that gradually we are correcting that. And of course, between societies, science has to discuss also with society. Now, also Ignacy said that we don't have any firm definition of what open science is. We don't have something that says open science is exactly this. We know what open science does, but we don't know it exactly. It's a set of practices, but still we're not very sure about that. We have an understanding of what it's about, but because it's a very dynamic field, we have instances of open science that we discuss on. So I will try to answer this question, why we make a dialogue. And because I'm Greek, I read Latin. And in the secondary education in Greece, we learn less in Greek, but we learn less in Greek as, you know, the language of our ancestors. Sometimes when you focus on the language, you don't pay attention to the meanings. So this summer, on my coincidence, I took some of the scripts of my ancestors, and I was trying to read in order to understand more about them, their meanings. So Plato has written, has authored one of his latest works, is Sophist. If you are not familiar with the word, is someone who's very fluent speaker, someone who has some certain degree of knowledge on something, but he claims that he knows everything, and because he's very fluent, he tends to distort the truth with some tricks. So Plato, who was seeking for the true essence of things, he's trying to understand what kind of person is this sophist. So it's a part of a triple of dialogues: sophist, statesman, and the philosopher. The philosopher was never found, was never authored probably, but it's a very much anticipated work for everybody. The statesman is a very important work in the Plato's life, but the sophist was underestimated. And Plato is using this dialectic process. So he makes a dialogue between two persons there, and through questioning and answering, he tries to find the two essence of things. And because all of the works of Plato, they explore certain things, this one explores the being and the not being. So it's very, very philosophical. We will not go there. Very hard documents, manuscripts to read. Okay? Very dense and very challenging for every reader. But the Platonic dialogue requires the absence of contradiction. Everything must be clear and should have one true meaning. Okay? So should not be confused. So Plato says, asks this, is it now clear that he is a kind of a juggler? Okay? An imitator of realities. Okay? The sophist is someone who imitates the reality. And pretty much we have this kind of science here, these areas, these times, where people imitate things. We have retraction notes from journals. Papers are being withdrawn because of bad practices. Some people say that they did a study, but they didn't. They never did. That's why we need open data in order to be able to iterate some of their work and prove that actually it has been done. And whether he may not truly possess the knowledge of all the things about which he seems to be able to argue. If you are active on social media, you will face that all the time, okay? Everybody has an opinion, most probably not well documented, okay? But we insist on this opinion, and therefore we say our societies, we say our science, we say our economy, we say several things, because we think we know, but we do not know. This philosophy. Let's go to reality. As I said, I'm representing a very big network of research libraries, which is LIBER, the Association of European Research Libraries. We have 440 members, and we have one mission. We are devoted to open science. Our policies, tools, and infrastructures, we think, that are saving the research process and mindsets in favor of open. Okay? Everything that our members do is doing to this direction. And we have one mission, of course. We don't have the mission to be the best library network, no. We have the mission to enable our researchers to do the best kind of research. And to contribute to the growth and sharing of knowledge. 1 year ago, we inaugurated our strategy for the years to 2018-2022, and we set up a scheme that supports that. We have three steering committees on three large directions, and every steering committee has three working groups. So in total we have 9 working groups that cover many of the most important parts of the landscape. For instance, we have copyright, we have open access, we have innovative metrics, we have research data infrastructures, digital skills, and digital humanities, and many other. So libraries powering sustainable knowledge in the digital age means that we need create all these conditions in order knowledge in this very, very uncertain times in terms of society, in terms of economy, in terms of technology, is sustainable and can stay as long as it is needed. Now, the vision is that open access at the end of this period is the main form of publishing. Open access is a very, very important topic. Research data is findable, accessible, interoperable, and revisable. Digital skills underpin a more open and transparent research lifecycle. Research infrastructures are participatory, tailored, and scaled to the needs of the diverse disciplines. And tomorrow's cultural heritage is built on today's digital information. So what we produce right now is part of our cultures, part of our societies, so we need to save it now, not afterwards, because the layers that we are saving are not as persistent as we used to have. Paper, stone, and so on. So we have to save it now, not 20 years after. And when we started drafting the strategy, we understood that libraries have to cover every step of the research life cycle. And we are here as libraries, as librarians, in order to assist our researchers to plan, to support them to have access to information, to manage those kind of information assets, to publish somewhere that is good, and to be able to assess what they have published, and to be able, of course, to reuse, okay, in order to keep more water inside the stream. The strategy is one thing, and then we had to make it more concrete. It's a high level document as a strategy document, but we need to be more practical. So we issued this open science roadmap, which is not far away from what Paul previously presented. You can find the link there. But I'm very glad that this is also part of a dialogue. Okay, it is not. It was not written by just some experts. We gathered a couple of colleagues around the table, but we took this document and we took also the strategy to our members, and we discussed that, and we made some amends, and we try to make it more relevant to everybody. It is important again to say here that the roadmap and other policy documents that LIBER has produced the last couple of years are taking into account that we have libraries working on different levels. We understand that there are different conditions in the UK, different conditions in Scandinavia, different conditions in the Balkans, different conditions in Spain, different conditions in Central Europe, in the Baltics, and there is no single solution that can serve everybody. So we are making recommendations, and I will show you a couple of our recommendations. But these recommendations are flexible enough so that everybody can adjust to it. Of course, when somebody recommends, I think this is a personal opinion, when I try to implement things in Greece and in Patras, should not be guilty. Okay. We are not guilty because we cannot implement everything. Okay, so let's leave our guilt outside and concentrate on the actual work. Paul said that those are pillars. I'm saying that these are topics, but these seven topics are what we discuss in this open science roadmap, scholarly publishing, fair data, research infrastructure, and the metrics and rewards, open science skills, research in science. This document, again, was not produced in a vacuum. Okay? It was produced because we know that the landscape is changing. We monitor things. We try to save together things. And I will show you that these are the LIBER topics, these are the LERU pillars, and these are the OSPP Open Science Policy Platform topics that more or less we are guided by. Okay, so we are trying to be relevant to the entire process. We are trying to be very, very close. And there is no way to reinvent another wheel that might not lead somewhere. We just see what other associations are doing, and we are trying to adjust that to the particular roles of the libraries. So I will give you a couple of examples of what our libraries can do and in this roadmap. But of course, because our audience is mixed, if you are a researcher, you may have some ideas what you can ask from your library. That's why I said this is a dialogue. Okay, so if you find something that it's missing from your library, you go there and ask, can we implement this? Can we start developing this? If you are a librarian and you think that this is good, yes, find your researchers and ask them if this is useful to them. So scholarly publishing, as previous speakers told, and show that there is an open science policy or an open access mandate in your institution. This is very, very, it's elementary. Champion open science by embracing a new role as the direct publisher of information. UCL is one of these examples. Stockholm University Press is a second example. And we are talking about university presses guided, directed by the libraries. And of course, they are dealing with this very, very difficult material that's called textbook or monograph. Commit to following our licensing practices for open access. We have five principles that you can follow when you are negotiating with the publishers. For instance, in Greece, we are discussing, our consortium is discussing the renewal of the big deals with all the big publishers, and we're trying to implement those things that we learned from the open access working group and the principles, and examine new models for journal delivery, such as mega journals, as a format of popular among research funders. From this set of recommendations, I think the first one is very, very important, because it says that invest in staff, invest in people, invest in skills. With good data skills and trained personnel to promote fair principles, work to make the use of fair compliant output, data management plans. Certify your repositories. If you have a repository, there are certain certifications that you can check against. You can acquire. For instance, we have a very, very small 5 minutes on progress. That's the bad thing when you are a Greek and you are discussing about philosophy and you understand that we did that without wine, okay? We did that without wine. automating metadata projection and so on, advocate for copyright legislation which supports fair data. This is very, very important. Generally, LIBER calls for some support during copyright reform. As a director and member of the board of directors of the consortium, I had to write down a letter to the minister and say, look, those entities are very, very important. LIBER provides this guidance. Okay, we are not people of, we are not lawyers. So we have this expertise in LIBER and this can be accelerated among our network. So presenting infrastructure in the EOSC, the European Open Science Cloud is very important. For the forthcoming weeks, and 2 weeks ago we were in Vienna and we showcased how libraries can help the implementation, the development of European Open Science Cloud. Metrics and rewards, very, very important things, because if we want things to change, we need to change the reward system. Open Science Kits, again very important. LIBER is doing a lot of work on developing the skills of our members. We have two programs for senior or senior administrative staff. And of course we have a new working group that works on this area. Recessive equity, participate in establishing codes of conduct. Some of these things are not present in universities. Some of these things need to be written down from the scratch, and it's actually, I will speak for my university, for my country in general, it's a shame that the Greek state has not taken any action on this so many years ago. Citizen science, promote the library as an active partner in citizen science, and use the library as an organizing and managing body to ensure that responsibly conducting good scholarly practices are expected when participating. I mean, the library can be a stop where people who want to practice all citizen science can go there. Now, text and data mining means that I am able to go there and mine thing, mine information from the text. If you don't have open licenses, then you cannot do something like that. Of course, this is an exercise that I did with my colleague Moses Boutouridis, who is a professor of mathematics. This is a network of terms that we mine from the open science roadmap. So we said, okay, we written something. Let's see if this something reflects something else. So these are the key agents, researchers, funders, libraries, publishers, authors, and then there are topics mentioned in Open Science Roadmap. You can see that this graph, this network graph is very interconnected. How big is the bubble? It means that this term is mentioned most times within our document. And then the connections is how important, how well connected is open science and libraries. And we did that by measuring, calculating how many times each word was co-occurred in a sentence in this document. And I have done that also for Leroux and OSPB. And you can see differences that everybody pays attention to other things. Now, cultural change, we said, what we can do is to use training and advocacy to foster common understanding. It was said before, we need to understand the same thing, otherwise it will not work. Okay, this is a minimum requirement for any kind of dialogue that we speak. First of all, the same language, not language like Greek or Serbian. But we say open science and we mean the same thing. That we mean say open access and we mean the same thing. Ensure that your institution has an open science policy. Reflect your commitment to open science, cross-sell services. There is an institution in Greece that says we are doing everything open. I have we released a new version of our system called Open Something. And when I tried to find the code, I was not able. Okay, so you practice what you preach. And share inspiring examples. If you have any inspiring examples, then share it with others. Don't be afraid that you get copied. If you are get copied, it means that you did something good. Okay? Now, why make a dialogue? Because we talked about, and this is the last few slides. I will make a revision. I will not go back to Plato. Not Socrates, not Aristotle, no. I will go to Robert Oppenheimer, who says, this open access to knowledge, these unlocked doors and signs of welcome are marked open freedom, as fundamental as any. They give a freedom to resolve difference by converse. And welcome back that not unite to let tolerance compose diversity. This is something that is missing from this world that we are living. Okay, we do not have tolerance. We do not have an understanding of how the others work. Open science is something that needs many people to work. Collaboration is a key element. So we need to be working together with other people. Otherwise, it will not work. We have to be tolerant. And sometimes we have to be tolerant for the ignorance that some colleagues have. Okay, so we have to help the others, and this is very important if you have open science to move together for a better future. So thank you very much.